hotline. I'm going to send you this PowerPoint. I don't think you're in the room, and maybe you can distribute so people have this information. But what happens is when they call that hotline, we have worked with the National Human Trafficking Hotline to build up a specialized Texas response. And so they know who to call, who to give that tip to, and then they also call our specialized advocates. Our advocates are dispatched. They respond within 90 minutes on scene with that officer. If it's confirmed that they're trafficked, right? The officer, they go and they do the investigation, and then the advocates respond within 90 minutes, and then they go through what we call care coordination. Where are they gonna stay? They help them find a place to stay if it's not safe for them to be at home, all that good stuff, and then they continue the services. So that's what it looks like. The survivor advocate, they are available 24/7. It's relationship based. They display unconditional positive regard. Y'all, that is the therapeutic term for unconditional love. Doesn't that sound a lot like God the Father? And then they meet youth where they are at, physically and mentally and emotionally. That's our response. They help them first with external regulation. When they have those trauma responses, they help them regulate. Then they help them begin to then co-regulate. And then eventually, y'all, they can regulate on their own because they're being healed. Again, they meet them where they are at and their state of change. And it's really working, y'all. So excited to see these kids there was a kid who's recovered. The mom was like, help me, I don't know what to do. She's gonna run again. And this time she assaulted me. I'm scared of her, I can't bring her home. If I don't get help, my kid's gonna die. So we were able to dispatch an advocate. The kid had ran like 8 times. Mom was at her wit's end. Mom didn't want her to come home. It wasn't safe for her to go home. So we were able to put her in one of these specialized residential treatment centers. The kid was there 3 months and hasn't ran. And so it's working, and they stay in close contact with their advocate. Now, sometimes they do run. I mean, that's like the perfect story, but their kids are going to get dysregulated and they're going to run. But what we're seeing is when they run, they contact their advocate and they text them and say, guess what I did? I got upset. I think I'm going to be in trouble. And the advocate talks with them and coaches them back, and they return and they run less. It's working. We have advocacy programs. We have 7 that we have funded. The blue shows where they are throughout the state. It's coming, and eventually we'll have the state covered with this. We are using our child's advocacy centers to play the care coordinator role across the state. That's what that slide's saying. And again, this is a sample plan for survivor care. We meet their emergency needs, provide urgent care, support restoration, and then build resiliency within them so that they don't fall prey to this type of exploitation again. What we've learned is a lot of our agencies who are providing services don't understand the trauma. So we have a lot of work to do across the state, not only for kids who have been trafficked and victimized in that way, but kids in general. A lot of our kids, y'all, have received trauma in various different ways, and we don't understand it. And so we are funding programs to go into these systems so that they are trauma-informed. And it's not enough to be trauma-informed. We are saying you have to be trauma-responsive. You have to take that knowledge now. Let's see it in action. Because if you're not doing it, it's not good enough, and we're going to be in your business until you do. So we are looking to find holistic services for these kids. And as I said, we're divided into regions, East, North, South, Central, and I get the privilege to be the East Texas Regional Administrator. So I am the person for you guys in the whole East Texas region. And then lastly is to bring justice. Y'all, we have to do a culture change here. We have to make sure our law enforcement, our prosecutors, our judges understand this complex trauma, and they understand that it causes them to appear complicit. Because I talk to a lot of people in that field, and they're like, well, they just want to do this. They keep going back. And it's like, no, you don't understand the trauma. Please don't say the word child prostitute. There's no such thing, right? And so there's a lot of training that needs to happen, a lot of education to help people understand that. So we are bringing in experts from all over to change. We had a training for our judicial system out in the Harris County region. The people from all over the state came and began to understand what this looks like and making sure that they understand the laws around it. Because we have laws now to protect our children. And yeah, just a lot of work to strip these cultural norms. What can you do? Certainly, and I'm going to say it again, please pray, y'all. Please enter into the spiritual realm and go to fight for our 79,000 kids and our 313 people who are trafficked across our state. I mean, my job is to focus on sex trafficking, and we barely brushed the surface, really, of sex trafficking. We're working hard, but labor trafficking is a whole other problem, y'all. Pray, okay? But also learn about it. Thank you for listening to me ramble about this issue and taking the time to understand, thank you, why these people, because I think my job is not to only do the strategies to bring the healing and to bring justice, but I want people to understand it so that they have compassion and empathy and love for these survivors. Please Google that. Be the one. Attorney General's office will pop up. Watch it. Be Debbie Downer. Have your friends over. Be sad for an hour, but also be encouraged that you have the ability to do something about it. Share on social media. You know, when you see things, I see things all the time. You know what I'm seeing a lot is our kids are missing. I don't know if y'all have seen that on Facebook a lot. It seems like every time I get on, I'm inundated with posts about this kid's missing. Share them. In fact, I got one this morning, and I realized this kid was missing out of Sugarland. That's my region. And so I took that, and I'm like, wow. And I saw this mother just putting all these posts, she was just devastated. And I'm like, okay, is this for real? Because sometimes the things they say, it makes you wonder, is this for real or someone just... So I forwarded it to one of the people who, one of our partners, Childproof America, whose child was trafficked by the high school basketball star as a teenager, and she fell into trafficking. And this mom is on a mission to help parents who go through this. And her child, this mom's child, was missing just like that. And they had a horrible, horrible experience trying to find their child. So I reached out to that mom. I'm like, did you see this? She goes, yep, I'm on it. I've already called her. And we're trying to get some help. We're getting some, you know, we're helping her with law enforcement to know how to navigate the system. So anyway, share on social media. Let's be aware of this. Prevent. You know, invest in kids. Be mentors. Help build that resiliency. Let them know they are loved, they are treasured, they are valued, and they should let no one speak to them that way. Because if we don't do it, we have these evil, you know, these evil forces of the enemy out there that's going to do it. And we need to protect them. And then support. Also, I want to point out CASA. That's a great way. If you guys have a local CASA, become a CASA if you have the time. Big Brother, Big Sister. Big Sister. And then if you have the means financially, get to know these nonprofits that are doing this work. We can't give them all the money that's needed. We just don't have it, right? And so we rely on a partnership with the philanthropic community to go in and support. Let's do this together because it's very expensive to fight this fight. And then if you see something, say something. You know, don't ever be guilty of not saying anything. You know, things come across your path, and what are you going to do with it? And if it's not your role to determine if it is or if it isn't. There are other people who are paid to do that, who are trained to do that. When you watch the Be the One video, you'll see that's what people did, and it saved so many people's lives. So one thing I want to tell you too, again, go to our website, and I apologize, I don't see that it's, oh wait, it is on there. Well, our contact information is on there, but our website is gov.texas.gov, and then you can go to the Child Sex Trafficking Team from that. You can also go to the Attorney General's website, and you'll see red flags. I didn't spend time on that because I just, you know, I could talk about this stuff all day. There's so much to know. But familiarize yourself with the signs, what it looks like. Just be educated to that so that you can make those calls. They're on the Attorney General's website, and then you can find them. You can navigate our website to find all that information. So that's all I have to say about that. Thank you again for your time. Really appreciate it.
Y'all, can we just give her another round of applause for everything that she's poured out and shared with us on this morning? Thank you.
Thank you.
So powerful, so needed. And I cannot pay you for what you have poured in, but I want to give you a token of appreciation for being here for sharing with us.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. We have one more presentation. We're going to bring up Ms. Sandra Polly, and she's going to give a brief presentation over her counseling services.
Okay. Thank you. I want to thank Janet. Oh, she's gone already. Thank Janet so much for that powerful presentation, you all. Oh man, she's talking about she has passion for what she does, and I can identify with that because I'm a licensed professional counselor. I'm national board certified, and one of the things that my specialty is in trauma that I focus on. And so just with that being said, I wanted to just to briefly share with you that as she was talking, what came to me is that a lot of times that we as people do not get involved because sometimes we have issues going on in our lives to where we think that, well, I got enough stuff of my own going on, so I ain't gonna be bothered, you know, with that. I let somebody else do it. But just to briefly share with you the importance of taking care of your own mental health, taking care of your own issues that you you do may have going on. And I wanted to let you know that God has gifted each and every one of us with gifts to be able to serve others. Okay, whether you realize it or not, God has gifted each and every one of us with gifts to be able to serve others. That's the type of God that He is. Myself, I'm gifted with the gift of counseling. I accept it. It took me a while to receive that and accept that about myself, but I accept that about myself. And I accept that I am a vessel of His to be able to help others just with the different things that come up in life that they may not know how to handle. So I just wanted to briefly just share that information. I'm licensed in the state of Louisiana. I should be, if the state of Texas have me down correctly, and from what I just got from them about a week ago, I should be totally licensed in the state of Texas by at least the second week in August, to where I could be able, because I provide teletherapy as well. And what that simply is that I sit at the computer and you sit on the other side of the computer and you still receive same quality services, okay? And so, but just with that, and then God has blessed me to be able to come to different conferences such as this, and I go to churches as well and community events as well, and just to speak on the benefit, the power of taking care of your mental health. And but He is blessing in that regard, and He's blessing, I know, because of my obedience. Because again, it took me a while to be able to recognize that this is what God has for me. And then I didn't want to do the hard thing. And so when I took that leap of faith and started doing that hard thing, y'all, I've been seeing blessings just pour out like crazy. And I had to get my stuff together, my mental health together to be able to help someone else. And so that's what I'm just admonishing as women of God, to be able to get the mental help that you may need, or may not even be the mental help, but just some challenges that you may have in your life that you just kind of been sweeping under the rug. Because the more you sweep, you're sitting there and you're piling that on top of your gift, and you are clouding your gift from even you, and then your gift from others as well. Don't do that. Don't do that to yourself. Be the vessel that God would have you to be, so that you can help others be the vessel that God would have you to be. And that's it. One last thing. My counseling services, it is entitled Integrity Counseling. And right now, like I said, I'm fully licensed in Louisiana, and should be licensed within by the second week of August, if not before, in the state of Texas as well. Okay. All right.
Thank you, Mrs. Polly. Y'all be sure to get her information, because that's something that we definitely in our community that we need to focus on, is our mental health. What we're going to do right now, we're going to take about 15 minutes, take a break. Everybody, you know, go out and get some refreshments, just, you know, kind of detox a little bit. And what I want y'all to be sure to do, stop by these vendors' tables. Let me pull the cards out. We have Miss Amanda Ashton at this first table here. And she has alkaline products, and she also has a book there for you guys to check out. It's called Rise Above. And then we also have Mrs. Doris McKelvey at the second table back there, and she is a Christian author. She has 3 books back there for you guys to check out. So just stop by the vendor's table, show some support, and we'll see y'all back here in about 15 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you. No, we ain't close.
Just a wing.
Well, I'm originally from Fort Worth. We moved here about 9 years ago.
And where do you live?
Here in Kansas. Born and raised.
Do you practice here?
Good
for you. Thank you. You're so welcome.
just looking. I went to go eat early and I'm just.
All right. People of purpose. Y'all good now? Y'all feeling refreshed? Y'all feeling restored, renewed, revived, and refreshed? So we're going to go ahead and open it back up with a song by Christina Cleaver.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Amen.
Thank God for this opportunity. I've enjoyed myself thus far. It's such an amazing experience. Praise God.
I love you, Jesus. I worship and adore you. Just want. Lord, I love you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Yeah. I'm Elder Carla Carter, and I just wanted to share briefly my testimony. The Bible says in Revelations 12 and 11 that we overcome him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. So I am here to share that I am a two-time breast cancer survivor. To God be the glory. And it's been exactly 15 years that I've been surviving. My journey began back in 2004, the first time I was diagnosed. I was diagnosed with an early stage, it was stage zero. It was a DCIS, a ductal carcinoma in situ, meaning that it was in one spot, it didn't enter into, it didn't metastasize anywhere. And so I went through having a lumpectomy and 6 weeks of radiation treatment. And then I went through all my mammograms and, you know, you go every 6 months and every 6 months, and I went and graduated to the 5 year and I was doing well. Well, lo and behold, 10 years, exactly 10 years later, I was in the shower and I was doing a self-check. Because if you've ever had breast cancer or ever had a mammogram and, you know, it was kind of a little off where you could go back again, you know that you always check your breasts, you know, a lot. And so I was checking my breasts and I felt another lump. I couldn't believe it. And so I, you know, went to the Lord in prayer and believed God. And, you know, I went back to the doctors, and of course I had to have another biopsy. And they tell you in 48 hours, we'll give you the result. Well, they called me in 48 hours and they said, "Ms. Carter, I'm sorry to inform you that you have breast cancer." And I don't know if you've ever had a call like that and heard those three words, "You have breast cancer." When you hear that, it's like your life changes. It's never again the way that it was. Because after that, you have all kinds of doctor's appointments, all kinds of tests, your surgeries, blood work, MRIs, CAT scan, just you name it, you've got to go through it. And so immediately I had to see the surgeon, and I'll fast forward to make this quick. I can't give you the big detailed version. But anyhow, I ended up September 23rd, 2014, I ended up having a bilateral, a double mastectomy. I removed both breasts. And I had immediate reconstruction, meaning that it was a process called dip flap, where they did a minor tummy tuck and they cut me from side to side and removed the tissue, the fat in my belly and the blood vessels, and they created breasts. It was a 7-hour surgery. I had three surgeons and I was in the hospital for 4 days. But to God be the glory, I'm doing well and I'm continuing to survive and I'm telling my testimony. I also had 7 lymph nodes removed from my right arm, and they checked all of those and they were clear. There was only one that the cancer was almost trying to think about coming through, but to God be the glory, it did. So I just thank God for my testimony. I didn't have to take any chemotherapy because the type of breast cancer that I had was caused, it was estrogen driven. So I take a drug called tamoxifen for 10 years and it's a hormone blocker. And so I just live on the word of God and the prayers of myself and the saints, and I'm just believing God that he has a work for me. And, you know, I just continue to testify about the good things that he has done in my life everywhere that I go. I want to leave you with this. The statistics say 1 in 8 women in the United States will be diagnosed with breast cancer. So when you look around this room, if you count down the line, 1 in 8 women. So I just wanted to tell you today to make sure that you get your mammograms yearly, because early detection is very important. It's key, because both times that I had the breast cancer, it was early. The second time was stage 1, it was 2 lumps, but it was early. So I was able to be able to make decisions, and you know, I'm here today. So I just wanted to share that with you. God bless you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for sharing that testimony. I want to also now call Charlotte Bussey to come share her testimony.
Amen.
Well, I don't think I want to go up and say.
Yes, ma'am.
To God be glory, and I'm so privileged to be here today. And my scripture is Jeremiah 29:11. I've stood on that for some years now, because I know that God had plans for my life, even though I went through a drought in my life. And I stand here today as a recovering addict. Not only recovering addict, but I'm recovered from prison. And God has just blessed me tremendously that I went to prison for my last time. I came out in 2015. And since then, I have finished college and got my associate's degree. I am now a substance abuse counselor at Alpha Recovery in Dallas, Texas, on Washington Boulevard. And I am helping other drug addicts get relief from that drug addiction. So if you have any family members that are suffering from a drug addiction of any kind, I welcome you to come to Alpha Recovery. And let us help you to get your relative back on track. It took me a lot of years because I didn't know about these different organizations. Nobody told me about them. It was just like pray and God will relieve you of your addiction. Well, that happened too, because when I got out in 2015, absolutely God delivered me from drugs. I never had to go to NAAA. Or any group therapy at all. I mean, it just left. It's just like it was never there. I'm just brand new. And I'm just so privileged to be here. This is my cousin, Cassandra. I drove from Dallas, urban area, because I have to be in a setting just like this. And I ask the righteous ones to continue to pray.
Amen.
She'd been the cousin that was always in prison, always on drugs. And the Lord allowed us to meet in Bobo, Texas, at our great-grandmother's homestead. And I didn't know my mother was getting ready to die. And we met that Sunday, and my mother passed away, and she came all the way back to be with me at her funeral. And we've been connected ever since. And she was still struggling in her addiction. And we connected. And she just said, cousin, just pray for me. And just be here for me. And so when we do this thing called ministry, Sometimes we think it's all about this. But ministry is being able to consider yourself, open up your spirit, and intercede no matter how it looks. Because it was times when Charlotte was calling me and saying, "Cousin, pray for me. Cousin, can you do this for me?" She wasn't right, but it wasn't for me to judge. It was for me to pray her through. And she's here today as a living testimony. And she just turned 70 last week. She just got her associate's degree last month. And she's doing substance abuse counseling right now, 69-70. And she's now getting ready to start working on her bachelor's degree at 70 years old. Charlotte Blaise.
Yeah. What do you have on your head? You have a helmet of what? You have a breastplate of what? And what are you girded about with? Okay. And what do you walk in? Oh my goodness. You walk in peace. Yes. You love. I had to say this because this isn't your usual prayer conference. It's a commission in charge conference. You need to know that few though you may be, many that you will impact.
Come on.
Changing their lives forever. Changing their lives forever. So because you were obedient, because you had the passion, you will do great works, greater works than you have ever seen. I was just so moved when my sister came here and talked about the sex trap. And you know, we have a lot of problems in our world today. And this sister was declaring things that had to do with her profession that is so applicable to what we're about as ministers of the gospel.
Yeah.
You're in the world, but you're not of it.
Amen.
We were sent here to minister to those in the world. But I came here also to say, you leaders, you preachers, you singers, all those who are reveling in your gifts, make sure you carry it through, because it's more than about you. And please, I'm not trying to offend anyone. I love you. I don't know you personally, but you're my sister. You're my brother. We're one. And when we move corporately, it is amazing what is accomplished. This is Central Texas. Did a little research. The sister said you got to research. You got to identify. You got to recover. You got to build up. Because you see, your ministry, your discipling, you will preach more without actually preaching than you will when you are preaching. Because people are watching. And people are following. So where are you leading them to? And how are you doing that? That's important. And time is of the essence. I want to leave you with an acronym. When you think of time, that's T-I-M-E. But when you turn it around, it's M-I-T. Are you emitting? Are you emitting your Heavenly Father? Are you reflecting what He tells you? How He wants you to move and be in this earthly realm? Think about that. Think about why you came. Think about what is in you, the seeds that are in you. Our sister shared with us her testimony also. And my sister Carla, my goodness. My, what is in you? It comes up and out. Be mindful of that. Up and out. God spoke it into existence.
Yes, He did.
So can you. You're here. You're about Him. Never doubt. When you find yourself going into doubt and worry, stop it. have much time. I had to flow with the Spirit. But I just want you to know, you press on toward your mark, to the mark of your high calling of God in Christ Jesus. You will do it. You will make it. And I say it is.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we honor you and we thank you for this next time. You told me to talk about success. Success has a face. So as I touch her hands, anoint her mind. May you take her to the places that she's never been. But the places she's prayed for, put before you and requested that a rest in it. Let her know that for you in this season, it will be effortless. Shanda, he comes, sails. Father, in the name of Jesus, Hezekiah turned his head to the wall. All he asked for was a little bit more time. I pray now that you will put a time extension. I come against every infirmity, every illness that will try to attack her body. I speak over it in the name of Jesus. I bind every spirit in the evil realm that would try to bring sickness upon her, either whether it's in her mind or physically. She has so much work to do. Oh, she's the one that can go in the enemy's camp. She's the one that you can use to bring them out. So I pray that the anointing fall fresh on her every day, as the dew does in the morning. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. We speak it, we declare it, and we believe it. May the compassion she has for others touches him, the power of God will touch them like he touched her. That healing will take place just because she hugged him, just because she touched him, just because she walked in the room. And I thank you and I praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. I bind the spirit of worry, the spirit of control, the spirit of right nowness, that I release the peace of God, that it will rest in her, that the voices that she hear will be the voices that speak love, contentment, open up her eyes to see in the miraculous hand of God, continue to operate in her life and in the life that she loves. God, you know what you're doing. It's all a part of a much bigger plan than hers. Let her wrap her arms around me, like I'm wrapping my arms around her, that she will believe in the impossibilities that can only be done with the power of the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, put your hands together for me. Come on. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for this vessel. Yield her first. She does so much intercession for others, thinking that she's gone unnoticed, but you told me to tell her, I see you. Because I believe in being timely. I am a product of Bishop Thomas Lee Jakes in the Potter's House. I launched my ministry, Heartfelt International Ministry, 2 years before I joined the church. And now I am celebrating 18 plus years of full-time ministry. I hold the job. Seemingly, you know, it took some time to believe in God to tell you to do something that you didn't want to do. But when you love God, it's not about you. It's about submission. And so I thank God that he has kept me and my husband. We educated all four of our children. All four of them have undergraduate degrees. One has 2 masters from Harvard University. My daughter's a banker. They all are citizens, homeowners. I got some beautiful grandchildren, and I can tell you that God did it. I'm going to follow my assignment. One of the things when I asked Elder Cassandra, what would she like for me to talk about? She said, I just feel in my heart that you should talk about Acts, the 12th chapter. And I do believe that. So I want you to look at your neighbor and tell them, success has a face. It does. And so if you have your Bible, and I'm going to kind of glance at it, teach at it so we can move forward. I'm going to give you some points. I want you to write them down. Go back, read that text, and study, exegete the text so that it can minister to you. Because you're getting ready, young lady, to launch out further into the deep. And so fear will grip you. Self-doubt will kill you. And secrets about what you're trying to do to put on the mask that everything's all okay. It's not. You just got to trust that success has a face. So when fear come on you, and it will, and when self-doubt tries to track you down, and it will, you will tell yourself, success got a face. And this is the face. This is the face. Because it's going to happen. Philosophy. philosopher Abraham Kaplan makes this distinction about problems and predicaments. He says a problem is something you can do something about. Okay. If you can't do something about it, then it's not a problem, it's a predicament. Say predicament.
Predicament.
That means it's something that can be coped with, something that must be endured. When you treat a predicament as a problem, you can become frustrated, angry, and depressed. You waste energy and make bad decisions. Then when all of your attempts fail, you give up and see yourself as a victim. Y'all want me to read that one more time?
Wow.
That's real good. Yeah. Philosopher Abraham Kaplan, K-A-P-L-A-N, makes this distinction between a problem and a what? Predicament, okay? A problem is something you can do what about? If you can't do something about it, then it's a what? Problem. No, it's a problem. It's not a problem. It's a what?
Predicament.
Thank you. You were listening. This means it's something that must be what? Coped with. Something that must be what? Endured. Okay? When you treat a predicament as a problem, you become frustrated, angry, and depressed. You waste energy and make bad decisions. Acts 12:1 in the New International Version reads, and I'm going to read a little bit, so you follow along with me. If you don't have a Bible, share your Bible with someone. And if you don't have it with you today, go home, study Acts the 12th chapter, and study it all the way through the 19th verse. It starts off and says, it is about this time that King Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with a sword. I would call that a problem. He says, when he saw that this pleased the Jews, he proceeded to seize Peter. Now the problem is a predicament for who? Peter. Then it says, this happened during the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. After arresting him, he put him in prison, handing over to be guarded by four squads of four soldiers each. Herod intended to bring him out for public trial after the Passover. So now Peter's predicament is turned into a problem. So Peter was kept in prison, but the church, verse 5, was earnestly praying to God for him. That's a good thing. The night when Herod was to bring him to trial, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and sentries stood guard at the entrance. I mean, they had him locked down. Suddenly, somebody said suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared and a light stone in the cell. He struck Peter on the side and woke him up. Quick, get up, he said. And the chains fell off of Peter's wrist. Then the angel said to him, put on your clothes and sandals, Peter did so. Wrap your cloak around you and follow me, the angel told him. Peter told him, verse 9, follow him out of the prison. But he had no idea that what the angel was doing was really happening.
Hallelujah.
God put you in a place that a miracle be happening with you and you're not even conscious of it.
Come on.
He thought he was seeing a vision. They passed, verse 10, they passed the first, the second guard, and came to the iron gate leading to the city. It was open for them, what? By itself. Somebody said effortless.
Effortless.
And then when they went through it, and when they walked through the length of one street, suddenly the angel left. Verse 11. Now I want you to know, all this time, Peter was moving, shaking, chains was falling off of him. And look what happened in verse 11. Then what? Peter came to himself. Oh Lord, look at somebody and say, wake up.
Wake up.
Now I know without a doubt that the angel sent that the Lord sent his angels and rescued me from Herod's clutches and everything the Jewish people were anticipating. So he was very aware of what was getting ready to take place. The enemy is very aware of what's getting ready to take place. When this had dawned on him, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, also called Mark, where many people were praying. Those were people that were praying for him in verse 5. And Peter knocked at the outer entrance, and a servant named Rhoda came to answer the door. When she recognized, now listen here, she recognized his voice, and she was so overjoyed, she ran back without opening the door. She said, Peter, at the door. I tell you, God can open up doors for you that people say, is that Cassandra?
Come on.
Door, and when I looked at the door, it was Cassandra.
Yes.
But you're telling me that she's coming back to center to bring the word to us? When she in Dallas, she could be doing something. must be an angel. That's what they said. An angel? No, she ain't no angel. Her name Cassandra Bering. But Peter kept on knocking, and when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Peter motioned with his hand for them to be quiet and describe how the Lord had brought him out of prison. Tell James and his brother about this, and then he left for another place. Okay, so I want you to look at your neighbor and say, success has a face. One of the things that I gathered from just reading about what this philosopher said, and I have so much to say, but I'm going to make it real quick. So take these 5 points down. I'm going to walk you through them, and we're going to call it a day and go get some chicken. Number one, success has a face. Number one, the light will dim. The light's gonna dim. D-I-M. Meaning that in my house, my husband has put these can lights up, Carla, and he has this switch where, you know, he's trying to be fancy, and we can go up and down with the light. Except one day I moved the switch and nothing would go out. And then I hit the switch again and everything went out. But there is a season in your life that the lights are gonna dim. Okay? We're gonna talk about that. Number two. There's a miracle in the dark.
Come on.
Sometimes we'll be looking for the light, but it's really in the dark. Number three, a glimpse of hope. My point is not wide enough. Yeah. A glimpse of hope. Number three. Number one, the light will dim. Two, there's a miracle in the dark. Three, a glimpse of hope. Number four, blessings behind closed doors.
Hallelujah.
Number five, go. And number six, show and tell. Here in the scripture, we are talking about Brother Peter. Brother Peter already had a reputation. So it's not always those that are most likely to succeed that succeed. So Peter was the one that cut off the ear of the soldier. He told Jesus Christ that he was not going to be crucified. Peter was known as loose lips. And there are some real, if you know anything about the DISC assessment, there are some real similarities in Peter's behavior dimensions like mine. Is that sometimes I can be just a little edgy and I can be a little direct. But I thank God that through the testing and the trials of my life, I'm still a little direct. I can still be a little edgy, and I'm still going to tell the truth. But it's massaged in love and in direction. It is the testing and the trials of our lives that God uses to cultivate us, to develop us, and then to send us out. And so here we find that even though Peter had made, because he told Peter, he was direct with him, he said, Peter, do you love me? Since she has to feed my sheep. He asked him again, do you love me? Feed my sheep. And he asked him again, do you love me? Feed my sheep. So it wasn't like Peter was hard of hearing. He wanted Peter to hear what he was submitting to. There's oftentimes that God will bring messages to us that he will repeat them over and over again. Because sometimes we don't get it the first time. We don't get it the second time. And sometimes we don't get it the third time. But at one point in our lives, God will get our attention one way or the other. So here, Peter is in a situation that he did not ask for. As I mentioned in verses 1 through 4, it has already gone out a mandate, but Herod has lost his mind. And there are situations in which we're living in a climate right now that we're confused about, but we shouldn't be. Because as my sister mentioned too, she said, we're in this world, but we're not of this world. And God is wanting to use a remnant of people so that he can do and show miracle signs and wonders and exploits in our lives. They're not going to all look the same. Everybody's not going to be in a pulpit. Everybody's not going to be. Somebody's got to be in a marketplace. Somebody's got to sell some books. Somebody's got to write some books. Somebody's got to go to the jungle. Somebody. There's a place for everybody. Look at somebody and say, there's a place for you. But Peter had to go through this season once again without being in the company of Jesus Christ. There are some seasons that it seems like the lights go out and God is not available. But it is only in those times that we realize maybe there are some dim lights going on. Perhaps that's why there was just a season for you, Carla, to have a little break, because the big one was coming to give you a bigger testimony. If we could just change the lens in which we look at situations and say that all things really work for the good. It may not come like you think it do, but over a period of time, you'll be able to see that God has something much bigger inside of you. Look at yourselves and say, don't be afraid of the dark. Two, there's a miracle in the dark. It was known when you study the Word of God, and really, particularly the book of Acts, it is so awesome because I love the Paul story. Let me tell y'all something funny. First of all, this suit is too big because I left my dress at home. And all I got is some gym clothes. So I had to go find me something that is too big. I keep stepping on it. I keep pulling up on it, just in case y'all think, what's wrong with that lady? I had to go buy me something to wear today. It's too big. Pray for me. I didn't have time to go get no bill, okay? So anyway, there's a miracle in the dark. He's in prison. There were no lights in the prison. When you were in the dark, there's no light. But you got to always remember that there is light when you can't see any light, because it is the light of Jesus Christ. Oh, a hope of glory that will shine and gleam in your life. Everybody won't see it, but you will see it, because you'll sense it and you will feel it. And when it is the fullness of time, he will cut the lights on and everybody will see it. The Bible says, and the glory of God shall be revealed. Number three, he'll send a glimpse of hope for you. He won't leave you. I don't care what the situation, circumstances may be, God won't leave you, because you have been handpicked and you have been ordained to be the face of success. You may not look like much to your family. You may not look like much to your colleagues and those around you, but you just tell them, keep your eyes on me, because I've seen the light. I've got a word from God. I may look crazy to you, but God's got to finish the end to my story. It was a reason why I had to go through the dark. It was a reason why I had to sit in the dim lights, because God had a miracle there. And I believe that God will give you a glimpse of hope, because that's what he wants to do. He's bringing hope in a dark situation. He's putting us on our knees again. He's asking us to call on his name for what we need. He is our provider. He is our healer. He is our deliverer. He will make a way out of no way. For real, he'll do it. I don't care what drop season you in. Somebody might bring you some groceries. I don't care what kind of drop season you in. You may have to humble to yourself and say, I need something to eat. Whatever it is, walk that thing out by grace. I know it's just a season. Somebody say a glimpse of hope. Number four, there is blessing behind the doors. Verses 7b through verse 10. It is very clear here. Oh my God. He was asleep. I love it when God can put you in a deep sleep. That means you're immune from everything that's happening around you. My children are crazy. Stuff's going on. Money looking funny. Them, no kind of situation. I don't know about y'all, but I've lived through it all in the last 18 plus years, where people done fell off, fell back on, showed up, came around just to see if you were living, driving by to see if we had lost our house, wondering how we was getting our car, all of that. I've lived through all of that. But you don't know what's going on behind closed doors. Where I'm laying out before God, reminding myself, you called me to do this. You promised me you'd take care of me. You told me my children would be blessed. You told me my marriage would stay intact. I thank you, God. Give me peace in this situation. Somebody say miracle. They said, you have an unusual mammogram, and we want you to come in. So, you know, I'm a researcher, so I'm all online trying to figure out, oh, God, what does this mean? Because I don't even have none up there. This got to be some kind of joke. And they reminded me, and have breast cancer. I said, well, why comes a man ain't got it instead of me? But I went on, and I prayed like all I'm going to do, because there's blessings behind closed doors. Yeah. I just gave that thing to the Lord, and he asked me one question. Is your yes still yes?
All right.
And I said yes.
Hallelujah.
So I went through that biopsy, but I knew it was benign.
All right.
They called me in 24 hours and told me it was. I didn't have to wait 2 weeks. Because, see, God's still in the miracle working business. It's just person to person. Her testimony is powerful. But she had to walk through what she walked through. But see, I had already watched my children bury their father. I watched my grandson be born in the middle of the service. I had gone through a biopsy. I watched my friends bury. All this is going on. I fell off a ladder, could walk for 4 months. I already had enough to have a track record to know that this too was going to pass. Look at somebody say, success has a face. So all the while, Peter was walking through this, sleep, in a vision, because he knew him best. See, he had to put him to sleep, because he would have thought that he was the one that was doing everything because of his personality trait.
All right, all right.
See, sometimes God will not allow you to do it your way. That's why he said obedience is better than what? Sacrifice. It doesn't require you to have knowledge or information. It requires you to surrender and be willing to suffer and sacrifice. So Peter had to have it like this because of who he was, his personality. He couldn't even believe it. But God knows so much about us that he will customize the test for you to walk through.
Right.
There is nobody in this room that is going through the same thing at the same time, the same way.
Right.
There may be some commonalities and some familiarities, but it's still some distinct differences. Some of us got predicaments and some of us got some real problems. But either way it goes, we serve the problem solver. So he sends an angel to do the work for him so that Peter would remember this. That's why I'll tell you that in a few minutes. Peter would remember what he made in terms of his encounter with the Lord. He said, Peter, do you love my sheep?
Yes, Lord.
Peter, do you love my sheep?
Yes, Lord.
He was telling him because he needed to hear it. It's something about hearing. It says, hearing comes by what? But we have to do what? We have to learn to what? Listen. And there was a sense of urgency. And so he just put him in his sleep. In verse 11, he says, then Peter came to himself. When we come to ourselves, there's only one word, and that is to go. Peter didn't have an entourage. He
whole lot of people around him. The angel was gone. He was by himself, but he came to himself and he realized,
I'm out. Yeah, I'm out.
Because when the change takes place, yeah, you will know it.
Amen.
Something about you will be different.
Amen.
The difference will manifest itself and you won't have to tell others, but they will see it. Because God will manifest his glory in and through your life. So he realized, he said, now I know without a doubt that the Lord, look what he said to you, y'all see that? Mm-hmm. Now I know without a doubt that the Lord sent his angel and rescued me. There's some things you got to know. And this is just a side thought. My inner circle is closest to my heart. They have a track record. When I'm in trouble, I send it to the same six folk because I know that through the trying of the testings of their lives, that they know without a doubt that it was God that did it. Amen. Who are you praying to and with? Who do you entrust your heart? Because maybe that person has something that they still are working on. They don't have the experience. It's obvious that Peter had to go through this in order to deal with what he was dealing with, because it is very apparent in the Word of God that he too had a little something going on in the prison. Maybe I'm going to get killed. Faith and fear collide. They never work together. But because Peter had already surrendered his life, made a commission that he was going to do what he was supposed to do, God put him in a trance and then woke him up and told him to go. And my last point is show and tell. Show and tell. The light is within. There's a mirror in the dark. A glance of hope. Blessings behind closed doors. Go. And my last one is show and tell. I'm going to tell you something. Peter kept knocking, and it reminded me so much of a conversation that I had with Elder Cassandra about her conference. She gave her heart, and she continues to knock. She took us through her community when she grew up and shared with us her story intimately. And yet God sent her back knocking in this community. Why? Because you were destined. It's just the beginning. Because a lot of people don't go and come to places that we should go and come. We like the big stuff. Well, I see nothing but generations of people when I'm looking at the audience. Game changers. Movers, shakers. Doers of the word and not just hearers of the word. And then he said here, look at this, and I'm done. Verse 17, Peter motioned with his hand for them to be quiet. And he described how the Lord brought him out of prison. When God brings you out of something, and he does what he's supposed to do, your testimony will speak for itself. You won't have to manufacture one. You won't have to create one. The testimony will speak for itself. All because you're willing to surrender, suffer, and your yes remain yes. You then become the face of Jesus Christ. Your hands and your arms become his hands and arms. Your feet and your legs become his feet and his hands. That's why he said, what? Are you not that the body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? Then we know that the Holy Ghost comes to lead and guide us in all things. So he's the one that's doing the direction. Thank you for knocking. bring it all back. And then we're gonna give it over to her. Come on, y'all, just put your hands together. And all of you that want prayer, just come stand behind her. And if I haven't prayed for you, then we'll pray together. Carla, you and Angela, come and take this oil, put it on your fingers, and put a cross on the forehead of everyone. Give it to Noah. Let me do Cassandra for you. Songs to wake him up. So I know the weight of being a straight person, but I thank you for your word. You said in Hebrews that you would never leave us nor forsake us. Quoted that in Psalms, when your mother and father have forsaken you, when they're gone, I will lift you up. Possibilities in her life. I pray for her son, her offspring.
God, thank you that he's not a statistics. He's a vessel. Trust you even when she doubts you. Let her know that you're with her even when she feels alone. She will get the glory out of her life in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. It's all in your name. It's in his name. You just let it go. You gotta always let it go. He got you. He does. May your work sprout out. Because the church needs it so bad. We need it so bad. There's so many hurting people sitting right behind you. Let them see you instead of her, that she will go in there and help break those chains. Generational change, adverse childhood experiences change, trauma experiences. These are for your glory in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. And just take the hand of the person next to you, because Elder Carla and Elder Angela have already touched and prayed with you. So just take the person's hand here. Thank you for your patience, for your time. Thank you for your love. Please support the vendors that have come out. Let's plant a seed. When I needed some money, I always planted a seed. I had released dollars that I didn't have. And I'll tell you a quick testimony. I told y'all. I was attending a service for a good friend of ours, and many of the people that are in Potter's house know Apostle M. Davis. And Apostle Pam Bennett was doing an offering. And I'm not an emotional giver. I'm a strategic and intentional giver. I have to know that this is what God wants me to do. So I'm not moved by a lot of emotional giving. I'm not even moved by what's in my checkbook. I'm moved by what God puts in my spirit. I've just been through enough. I've been pimped enough. And I've been made promises that did not take place. So I've studied the word about giving and really learned about giving. And I've seen God move my heart about giving. And so she was asking for an offering. So I had already made my check out. I didn't ask God, I just made a check out. But I said, I'm out. Here we go again. You know, that's my first thought. But as she began to minister to us, I could hear something in my spirit. That check I wrote, I left it in my purse. I told her they'd give me another envelope, and I wrote out another check. When I walked out of the church, what I wrote in the check was handed back in my hand. The next day in the mail, it was almost double what I gave. It was a reimbursement for being paying one of the diagnostic places. They had done a lot of, you know. That's how I live. Somebody say my faith. I ain't going nowhere. I'm used to it now. I'm gonna go home and put some clothes in. I told you I didn't want to come from your book.
You just gotta know God for yourself.
I love it. So I promise you nothing, but I'm gonna pray. If you want to give a gift to Cassandra Bering for helping her with this, I know she would appreciate it. I'm gonna give her a seat. I know good ground when I see it. And I used to tell people, I said, I know good ground when I see it. I just feel that she didn't know I was gonna do this. I didn't know I was gonna do it. I'm supposed to be through now. But I know it's God. Yeah. And each one of you all have something in here that you're asking God for. Trust me on seed planting. It's not a gimmick, it's real. So I don't do a lot of work now. Just say, give. And watch him. The scripture where they use a lot for God presents it to give, he'll give it back to you first. Okay, what that meant was there wasn't currency back then. They gave out of the need that they had. And when he said to give it back to them, press down, he said, more they gave them, even though they gave what they gave, they gave what they could give. But what came back to them was more than they anticipated. That's what that text means. But I've always been, well, if I give $100, I'll give $1,000 back. That's when the $1,000 didn't come, I learned something's wrong with that text. Told you I've been out here a long time. I learned. I'm looking for $1,000 to come down like mammal from the sky. Instead, I just went through another test. I'm like, there's something wrong with that text. There was nothing wrong with the text. It was a lack of interpretation. So that's what we're going to do. It's up to you. Father, I just thank you for every person that came out this morning. I thank you for every person that's standing around this altar. I thank you for the phenomenal testimonies, the beautiful song, how even the pianist and the drum, all of that came together last night. It's a miracle. We're in the journey with you, but God, we just knew everything was going to be all right. Prayer does change things, and when we have a heart to do what you want us to do, then we don't have anything to be afraid of because it's all gonna work out. So I thank you that you manifested that for her in this season because of where you're taking her next. Because the enemy tries to throw your plans, but the only way plans can be thrown that you put in our heart is that we quit. I pray that no one quits. But they will allow themselves to be the face of success. Because you said you have plans for us.
Yes,
your plans include prospering our lives.
Yes,
and bringing us into good health.
Yes,
that's mentally, physically, psychologically, emotionally, in all good places. That you will come against the infirmities that the enemy will try to attack with our bodies, attack in our mind and our spirit. But let us remember that we're one in you.
Yes,
and you're in us. So we thank you for this glorious day, and we give you glory and praise. I pray for every person that whatever gift they give, you give it back to them in a manner that you want to give it back to them. And I thank you for you have used so many situations where people brought money to my doorstep. People brought groceries to us. We never miss a house payment. You let me graduate from reaching debt free. You pay for every book, every airline, every place I stay. The cup never ran, never stopped running over. I'm a witness to what only you can do. Let them tap into that kind of faith. And I thank you as they travel back home or go to their various places, that they will share this message of hope. They will study Acts the 12th chapter and put themselves in that world so that they will know that you are who you say you are. That even as mysterious as the gospel is, it is true. And we thank you for that truth in Jesus' name. And everybody say amen. And just hug the person next to you and tell them you got the face of success. Make your checks out to Cassandra Bering Ministries. And when you get a chance, just put it on this stage.
Right.
Just like, thank you. Thank you so much.
Cash app, you could, or Zio app, you could do it to Cassandra Bering. Cash app, Cassandra Bering, and the Zio app, Cassandra Bering also.
Share what God had given me. I wrote Minister Bering. I had a dream about her. And I told her, I saw you putting, you had a building. And on the building it had Cassandra Bering Ministries. I said, I don't know what it is. I said, but whatever you need me to help you do, I'm willing to help you. And when I seen your stickers, oh my gosh, that was it. That was it. And I'm just like, God. And I wasn't going to say anything, but God was pressing me to say, He is really been the blessed. The ministry, and I told you, I said, I don't know what it means. You said, I don't either, but we're going to pray about it. God is taking you higher. There's going to be some places you go that you didn't even think you could get in. And I'm just excited because the colors. I seen purple. I seen everything. And God began to, I see stuff before it happened. And when I see it, I'm like, God, this is deja vu. You done showed this to me. You know, I got sick. God showed me I was going to get sick. He showed me my family in the room with me. I've seen it, everything. And so he's beginning to show me vision. And and they're coming to pass. They're manifesting. And so I know you're going to do some great things, and I'm here to help you.
Y'all will. Now, one last thing. I have a great, I don't even have as many words as I could put together, but it's an extreme honor of mine to bring to you my mother, way out of Fort Worth, well, first of all, out of Tenny Hall, Texas, then by way of Fort Worth, Texas, Elder Cassandra Bering.
House. And oh my goodness, I am sharing that I have not had much sleep at all for weeks, and I don't even know how I'm still standing with everything going on, but I know it's by the grace of God. And I've been saying I was like, I'm just troubled because I really need to be in a Mary space so that I can hear from the Lord, that I can do what my normal routine is before ministry, and that's to, you know, of course, we've been fasting and praying, and that's just to lay out before the Lord in a still, quiet place that I can really hear him down low what it is that I need to share. And so through the matriculations of my busyness, he just dropped Matthew 22 in my spirit about the king that hosted the banquet for his son getting married. And then he dropped just little drops, and I'm like, but you're not bringing this thing into manifestation. I can't exegesis this. I don't know where we're going with this. But now I know where he was saying to me all along about the gathering. You see, if you just read Matthew 22, I'm not going to read Matthew 22. You know the story, the parable, what Jesus was saying, what was likened unto the kingdom of God. And the parable was the invitation. The invitation was extended by the king. And the king is royalty. The king means headship. The king means oversight. The king means leadership. The king means one with governmental rule and authority. And he showed me the kingship. And he said that he was inviting all of the dignitaries, all of the important people, all of his friends. He was inviting all of those in his circle of influence. And every person he was giving the invitation to, because there was an expectation that they were in relationship, they knew him, they were familiar with him, that they would be excited and exuberant to come to the banquet. Why the king, he spent all that he had within his means to prepare the vision of what God showed him for the banquet. He laid it out, the vision, explicit for royalty, because he was a king, and he invited only those that were likened him in his presence. But everyone that he invited had an excuse that they could not come. You all have no idea how many hours I've been on Facebook, people's inbox messages. You have no idea how much money, my bill money, my car note money, my mortgage, and my light bill. Carry out the vision. And I'm inviting all of these people I've been knowing for years, people, everybody, inviting,
And then many promised to be here. Some even bought their tickets to be here. And something came up and they could not come. And I was getting so discouraged. And I remember the week before now, I was lying in my bed on Saturday morning and I said, Lord, should I cancel? Should I cancel? Should I cancel? Should I cancel? And I called up one of my newest oversights, Apostle Exum, and I said, I'm thinking about canceling. I said, because this is not matriculating as though I believe the Lord showed me that it was. And he says, well, just know, whatever you do, it's not a sin to cancel. But it is a sin to quit. So, 2-3 minutes later, I get a phone call from Anita, a.k.a. Sugar. Hey, Diva. I just called to check on you. He's on my mind. We talk, she calls me every week. I just called. It's my time. And how you doing? I said, oh, I'm not doing too well. I'm thinking about canceling. She says, oh, no. You can't cancel. You cannot cancel. I've been praying. It's going to be a success, and I'm going to be there. You cannot quit. And I said, well, this happened. And she says, oh, don't worry about that. I got that. You gonna have continental breakfast. I got that. And when it laid out like royalty, thank you. And then about 10 minutes later, I get a cash app. Well, Pastor Carla said, I'm gonna pay the vendor fee. She doesn't even have a vendor table. 2 hours later, I get another cash app. $150. So I said, okay, God, that was the sign that I asked you for in my prayer, not to cancel. And so my point is that I'm just a vessel. Of hope. Hope of what God can do in your life. Hope never to give up. Hope that you can live past your mistakes. Hope that Romans 8:28 says, for we know that all things work together for the good of them who love the Lord. Hope for my cousin Corey that pressed his way. Show the t-shirt you designed. You see, we're the remnant in the gathering. We're the remnant for our families. We're the remnant for our families. We're the remnant. Corey, I maybe talked to him the day I preached his father's funeral and loved on him. Never grew up with him, never knew him. But the Lord put in my spirit, Dr. Kathy, just as every person that he told me to invite to be here, he showed me everybody. And everybody that I invited to be here didn't come. And then I said, well, Lord, this is really for somebody. I said, well, Lord, did I not hear you? Am I schizophrenic? Am I tipping over into some mental health issues? Because it's really a close dichotomy when you're operating in the spiritual and when you're operating in the natural. And what has happened in the culture of church is a lot of mental illness. Hallelujah. It's mass. By spirituality and emotionalism, and we got issues in the church where people have been sexually abused, have been molested, have been trafficked, have been bound by addiction, generational curses, and what the church does is dance and shout and holler and run around the church 7 times, jump up and down, roll on the floor, and nobody getting set free and delivered. Oh, but he set me as a deliverer to birth you out.
shout, we're going to dance, we're going to pray, but we're going to get some therapy, and we're going to create a space just like this, where we're going to be real and talk about it. Ain't no more family secrets. Ain't no more family secrets. Because the light of Christ, hallelujah, shines light on every facet of darkness. And he does not condemn. He loves, restores, delivers, heals, and sets free. So I'm standing here as your sister, just as a beacon of hope. Everybody know me from Tenney Hall. So let it be resolved at the gathering. This gathering. That is the king that prepared a beautiful table for the banquet. And everybody's not going to come to the great feast. It's something. They didn't come for a free meal. I said, we have sponsorships. Everybody's not going to come. Who needs to be at the table will come. And there we are. So my prayer is that the vision God gave me to prepare this space, this atmosphere, was conducive to minister to whatever your need was. And if that be so, Summer, so my heart rejoices, and every tear, every struggle, every attack was worth it. To the glory of God. I love y'all. Hallelujah. Can y'all please support the vendors? I love y'all. Everybody that served. I have gifts. I have gift bags for those that volunteered, those that participated. Thank God for my son, Jacoy. Thank you. Awesome. Y'all give it up for Jacoy. Thank you, Dr. Kathy. Thank you. There's some people in this room I've never seen before. There's some people. There's Carolyn. I hadn't seen her in 30 years. We went to junior college in Lufkin, Texas. Hadn't seen her in 30 years. And she drove from Woodville, Texas to be here. Amen. Thank God for our vendors. Amen. Thank y'all for trusting the vision to sow and to be here. Have y'all been supported? Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Is there anything else? Any loose, anything? Am I forgetting anything? Amen. So when the Lord sends us back, amen, we're going to work on timeliness. My apologies for not starting promptly. And then we want to work on just being mindful of time. Amen. So we don't want to disrespect that. And we want to honor your time. And for those that have driven and come from far and near, thank y'all for being here. Thank you for your obedience to say yes. And I love you. I love you. Let's stand. Let's touch somebody. This is intimate. Thank you, everybody. I have t-shirts. Thank y'all. I know you've sewn. I know you've sewn. But if you want to have some memorabilia of this memorial of today, please. Lord God, how I just magnify your name. We give you glory. Give you honor. We praise you for drawing us here to the gathering. And that you chose us. You chose us. Many were called, but the few that are here, we were chosen. So as we go out, God, let us be about the purpose and the destiny in which you called us to. Let us be about that. Let us not be just busy. Let us be of thy purpose. And let us help each other. Let us come together in unity. And let us support one another for the advancement of the kingdom. Not for self-promotion, but for the advancement of the kingdom. So we thank you for every gift in here. Every gift that's known for you. We thank you for every impartation, spiritually, emotionally, relationally. We thank you for healing. We thank you for deliverance. We thank you for hope. And Lord God, we pray that as we leave this place, we will never leave your presence. Everything that's been poured out, oh God, bless them again. In the name of Jesus, we bless you, we honor you, and we love you. And the church says amen. Y'all are welcome if you want to take pictures of the backdrop. You're welcome to take pictures. Welcome to love on each other. Amen. Amen. We don't have to be out here at 1, but you know, if you have to get on the road, we understand. But you can mingle. Hallelujah. And love on one another. Amen.